The Gospel of Luke, chapter 1. Luke chapter 1, and in our blue Bibles, it's page 1588. I apologize if you can't read it very well in this dim light, but it is Christmas Eve. Page 1588 in our blue Bibles. Luke chapter 1, and I'll speak from the whole of verses 26 to 38, but to begin, we'll simply read verses 26, 27, and 28. So Luke chapter 1, and beginning to read at verse 26. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Father God, we thank you for this wondrous event that the Gospel of Luke records. And we thank you for this written record of this miraculous event when the angel Gabriel visited the Virgin Mary and announced to her the birth of the Christ child. And Father God, I pray that as we recall, Lord, this scripture, that you will speak into our hearts. May the Holy Spirit that inspired Mary, Lord, be working within us also and reminding us of the great announcement and the great wonder that it proclaimed that the heavenly Lord Jesus would be born from Mary. And Father God, we thank you for her faithfulness and obedience, and we pray that through these things you will speak to us and encourage us in our service for you, Lord. And so I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Ave Maria. Gratia plena. Maria, gratia plena. Maria, gratia plena. Ave, Ave Dominus. Dominus tecum. Those are the opening lyrics for the Latin Christian hymn entitled Ave Maria, and often sung to a melody by the 19th century German composer Franz Schubert. In English translation, they read, Hail, or greetings, Mary, full of grace. Mary, full of grace. Mary, full of grace. Hail, hail, the Lord is with thee. Here in Luke chapter 1, we read about the angel Gabriel greeting the Virgin Mary by name and announcing to her the marvelous grace or heavenly favor upon her, and the ready willingness of the young woman to do what God asks of her encourages you and me to become the Lord's servants, like Mary, the mother of Jesus. Verse 26 recounts that 6 months after Elizabeth, the wife of the aged priest Zechariah, has become pregnant, God sends the angel Gabriel to the town of Nazareth in the region of Galilee. The name Gabriel means mighty man of God, and we read about him in the Old Testament book of Daniel, appearing to the Judean wise man and revealing to him the events that will happen at the end of this worldly age. The same angel has lately appeared to the priest Zechariah in the temple and has announced that his wife will bear a son, whom they should name John, and that amazingly and wonderfully, he will prepare the people of Israel for the coming of the Lord God himself. And now, 6 months after the long barren wife of Zechariah has conceived, God sends the angel Gabriel, not to Jerusalem and the temple, but to the small town of Nazareth in the north of Judea near the Sea of Galilee. Concerning this town, in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, the disciple Nathanael will say scornfully, Nazareth, can anything good come from there? And so we understand that the Judean people hold the town of Nazareth in some contempt, likely because it is simply unremarkable and politically unimportant. Nevertheless, God sends Gabriel to the lowly Galilean town, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. Verse 27 reads. The text introduces the girl as a Parthenos in Greek, or a young woman of marriageable age, who is clearly also a virgin. And considering marriage customs of the day, she is most likely about 16 years old. She is pledged to be married, but in a more solemn and binding way than couples in our society engage themselves to one another. The man she is betrothed to is named Joseph, and he has the distinction of being a descendant of King David, the one whom God has long ago promised that his descendants will rule over Israel forever. However, now, in this time of Roman domination and occupation of Judea, the royal lineage of Joseph has little political significance, and he enjoys no special privilege because he is a descendant of David. The name of the young woman whom God sends Gabriel to is Mary, or Miriam, as the Greek text reads. In the Hebrew, our Old Testament scriptures, this is the name of the sister of the lawgiver Moses and the high priest Aaron, and the woman who has helped lead Israel out of Egypt and through the wilderness. The New Testament scriptures mention five other women with the name Mary. And so we understand that it is a much liked but very often used name among the Judean people. So her common name, her unremarkable betrothal to Joseph, and her humble town of residence all imply that the girl whom God sends the angel Gabriel to is really quite ordinary. She has no special status or distinction and is only a simple Israelite girl. And indeed, this is how Mary will speak about herself in her song of praise to the Lord that appears later in this chapter. For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. Despite her common and lowly status then, the mighty messenger angel appears to Mary and says, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Although Mary is quite ordinary, the Almighty I Am has chosen to show her special favor. The Greek word for highly favored derives from the word charis, or grace, and speaks about someone who has been graciously gifted or generously endowed. In the case of Mary, she has received the gift or endowment of a very special heavenly favor. And the Lord God is with her in a wonderfully unique and amazingly extraordinary way. Maria, gratia plena, Mary, full of grace. Greetings, you who are highly favored. And I mean you. I mean you and me. Like the humble Judean maiden called Miriam, you and I are well favored. And the heavenly Lord Jesus is with us also. With us? The Lord is with us? You and me? We are highly favored? I don't know about that, you say. I think you are mistaken. You may have the wrong person and the wrong message address. I'm just ordinary people and not very important. But that is why God has chosen you and me and has decided to fulfill his purpose of salvation through us. That is why he has called us through the message of the gospel and has filled us with the Spirit of Christ Jesus. The Almighty Father is happy to choose the simple folk of this world for the display of his grace and for the demonstration of his power. Because through lowly people, his glory is so much more clearly revealed. As we read about in 1 Corinthians 1, verses 26 to 29. And that is why God chose Mary. The heavenly messenger did not come to a proud noblewoman or to the daughter of a high priest. Rather, the angel visited a common Judean woman and a simple teenaged girl, whose greatest prospect was her pledge to be married. And where was Mary living? In Nazareth, of all places, not in Rome and the center of worldly dominion, not even in Jerusalem, the holy city and seat of Judean government, but in lowly, unpromising Nazareth. Like Jasper. Can anything good come from there? Yes, it can. Because God knows where our little town is located. just as well as he knew where the small and lowly town of Nazareth was. For Christians, Mary has become a symbol of honor and even of veneration. And so we often overlook the profound lesson of her lowly simplicity. We might be just ordinary folk, like the teenage bride, Mary, and like her carpenter husband, Joseph. But through our belonging to Christ, we are sons and daughters of God and heirs of his everlasting kingdom. Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Gratia plena, full of grace. After greeting the young maid Miriam, in the next several verses, the angel Gabriel makes an astonishing announcement to her. Verse 29 recounts that Mary is greatly troubled by the words of the angel and wonders what he means by the greeting he has given her. In the Old Testament, when Daniel has first seen the mighty Gabriel, the man has become terrified and has fallen with his face to the ground. And here in Luke, when the angel has appeared to Zechariah in the temple, the priest has been startled and suddenly overwhelmed with fear. No doubt Mary feels a similar sort of apprehension at the appearance to her of the heavenly man of God. But at the same time, she also wonders about the meaning of his words. In what way is she highly favored? And how is the Lord uniquely with her? Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God, the angel says in verse 30. Gabriel assures Mary that his appearance means nothing ill for her, and he affirms that God has indeed chosen to show her special favor. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, verse 31 reads. The angel explains that the heavenly favor upon her will be revealed by what will soon happen to her. She will conceive and give birth to a son. And Mary should name the child Jesus, or Jesus, which is the Greek form of the Hebrew name Joshua, or Yehoshua, which means Yahweh saves. This son whom young Mary will bear, then, will be a deliverer. And like his namesake Joshua, Jesus will lead the people of God into their blessed inheritance. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. Gabriel continues in verses 32 and 33. The Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. Son of the Most High is an extraordinary title, and it implies a wholly unique relationship with Almighty God. The Old Testament speaks occasionally about a father and son sort of relationship between Yahweh God and the King of Israel. But the Hebrew scriptures never use the exalted sort of title the angel now foretells for the son of Mary. In verse 76 below, Zechariah will speak about his own son becoming simply a prophet of the Most High, because John the Baptist will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him. But in Luke chapter 8 and verse 28, a man with an evil spirit will recognize Jesus for who he really is, and will cry out in terms that recall the announcement by Gabriel to Mary about her infant son. What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? By natural or human lineage, Jesus will be a descendant of the righteous King David. And the Lord will give to the son of Mary the throne or kingship of his royal ancestor. Legally, Jesus will become the adoptive son of Joseph. And so the ancestry of Jesus will be traced through Joseph and his royal line of descent from David. And through Yehoshua, God will fulfill his ancient promise to the righteous king of Israel about an everlasting dynasty and a never-ending kingdom. Jesus will rule forever over the restored house of Jacob, or the people of Israel, but also over everyone else whom God will choose to include among them. Mary, did you know? The popular Christmas song asks, did you know that your baby son has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you? Yes, Mary did know, because the angel told her that she should name her son Jesus and that he would become the deliverer of his people. But did Mary really understand? Did she realize all that her son would do and become? And did she even imagine that the child she had given birth to is no less than the heavenly and ever-living Son of God? But here is the gospel and the amazingly good news for you and me, that the child of Mary is the great and immortal I Am, but also the mighty Joshua, who has come to save forever his believing and faithful people. The Nazarene maid Miriam received the announcement through the mighty angel Gabriel, messenger Gabriel. But you and I have received the same heavenly revelation through the centuries-old proclamation of the gospel, through the written scriptural record of the original events, and through the yearly celebrated occasion of Christmas. All the traditional carols and the many popular songs that sing about the birth of Christ Jesus. Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. And you and I have found favor with God also, because he has visited us with the life-changing message about his one and only son and about the salvation he has brought for humankind. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, Gabriel told Mary. And through our own belief in the gospel and the matchless name of Jesus, you and I have received the spiritual life of the living Savior within us. And we are being supernaturally born again with his likeness and graciously enabled to reproduce his own goodness. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And this is what believers and saints have called the child of Mary for generations now. Because we understand from the scriptures, from the councils and creeds of the church, and from the revelation by the Holy Spirit, that marvelously, Jesus is no less than the heavenly Son of God, the great I Am, become a man, and the living Word of God made flesh. And someday, some sure to come day, the Almighty God and Heavenly Father will give his one and only Son the earthly throne of his human forefather, David. And the immortal King Jesus will reign forever in a redeemed and renewed world over the resurrected and restored house of Jacob, and all the believing and adoptive children of Abraham, like you and me. And this is the gospel, the heavenly good news, and the same essential message the angel Gabriel shared with the young Miriam and mother-to-be of Jesus. But young Mary wonders how she can possibly become the mother of the deliverer and king of Israel. And in verse 34, she asks the heavenly messenger, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" Not only is Mary a woman of marriageable age, as the text has already mentioned, but she is also a virgin, or as Mary says literally about herself, "a man I have not known." If she is about to conceive, as the angel has announced, then how, she wonders, simply and innocently, not doubtfully and cynically, how will it happen? "The Holy Spirit will come upon you," Gabriel explains in verse 35, "and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." Mary will not conceive naturally from a man, but miraculously. The same heavenly Spirit through whom God has originally formed the world and made all the living creatures will come upon the virgin girl. He will overshadow her like the heavenly cloud of the presence of the Lord God has hovered over his people Israel in the wilderness of Sinai. And the result of the overshadowing power of the Holy Spirit upon Mary will be that the child whom she gives birth to will be truly holy himself and will even be called the Son of God. Because the miraculously conceived child of Mary will bear a holy, unique affinity and a one-of-a-kind likeness to the Almighty God himself. To encourage Mary to believe that this miracle will happen, in verse 36, Gabriel reveals to her that her aged relative Elizabeth, kinswoman, cousin, or aunt, is also going to have a child. She who is well past her childbearing years and whom people have sadly called barren is now already in her sixth month of pregnancy. And this revelation comes as delightful news for Mary and as wonderful encouragement for her to believe the message about herself and the son she will bear. If God has relieved the elderly Elizabeth of her childlessness, then the Almighty can even cause the young Virgin Mary to conceive miraculously. For nothing is impossible with God, the angel reminds the young Jewish woman in verse 37. "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answers in verse 38. "May it be to me as you have said." Mary humbly and obediently accepts the purpose the Lord God has chosen for her. To begin with, of course, her husband Joseph will not believe her explanation that she is pregnant because of a miraculous conception. Mary may already expect this reaction from him, but still, she submits herself to the will of the Lord and trusts in his care and provision for her and for her holy child. "I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." And may you and I have the faith and the humility to readily accept the service the Lord Jesus has appointed for us. And to willingly submit to the work of grace the Master has chosen to do within us. How will this be? We might ask simply and innocently, like Mary. How can the Lord use us? How can the Master accomplish anything extraordinary through us? The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. By ourselves, you and I are hardly able to be the servants of the Lord God. But through the heavenly Holy Spirit working within us, we are well equipped to become ministers of the glorious new covenant and to give birth to the goodness and grace of our heavenly Savior, Jesus. The Holy Spirit comes upon us supernaturally, and the power of the Most High overshadows us mightily, so that you and I may reproduce the life and the love of Christ Jesus, and so that we are able to perform the gracious works of service He has appointed us for. Gabriel revealed to Mary that her relative Elizabeth was going to have a child in her old age, and that she who was called barren was already in her sixth month. Miracles do happen. They really do. And God still answers the prayers and grants the desires of those who continue to wait upon Him in faith and expectation. And God will similarly grant us His grace and favor, so that you and I can perform the works of service and offer the gifts of ministry He has appointed us for. For nothing is impossible with God, the angel Gabriel said. And the Holy Spirit offers the same assurance today. Nothing is impossible with God. So all we must do is say along with Mary, I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. All we must do is believe and be willing to become the obedient servants of the Lord Jesus. May your Holy Spirit move within us, Father, and may you accomplish the work of your Son through us. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered the angel Gabriel. May it be to me as you have said. But what if she had refused to do what God willed for her? What if Mary had decided the message about a miraculous conception was too incredible to believe? What if the young betrothed woman had worried her husband Joseph would scorn her and divorce her? What if the virgin had feared that her Jewish family and friends would reject her for being faithless and impure? Surely the Almighty would have found another virgin willing to give birth to the heavenly Son and Savior of humanity. Surely the Father God would have known some other Judean woman willing to trust in His power to care for the Christ child and His blessed mother. Happily, however, Mary readily answered the angel, I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. And so, Mary became the mother of our Lord. What about you and me? Are we willing to believe in the grace of God working within us? Are we ready to do what the Lord Jesus asks us to do for his church and his gospel message? Are we prepared to say, like Mary, I am the Lord's servant? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this record of the birth of your Son. And we thank you for this record of the obedience and the faithfulness of his mother Mary. Father God, we thank you that you chose to do this wonderful and gracious work through a simple teenage girl. And Father, we thank you that you brought forth such a great and everlasting salvation through such a humble person. And we thank you for her example also, that she was willing to believe and that she was willing to do what you asked her to do, regardless of what might happen to her. And Father God, I pray that you will help each one of us to be faithful also. May you plant within our hearts the faith to believe in the great miracle of Christmas and the birth of the Son of God to the Virgin Mary. And Father, I pray that you will help us to be willing to do your part, the part that you ask us to do, Lord, for your gospel, the gospel of salvation through Christ Jesus, and for your church, the people that you are saving forever. And Father, I pray that, Lord, we will be willing in our own way and in our own place and in our own time to say, I am the Lord's servant. Father God, may you do this work of grace within each one of us, and may you fill us with grace so that, like Mary, we too will be full of grace and gracia plena, Father God. And so I pray in the matchless name of our Savior Jesus. Amen.
A thrill of hope, though we're
now, O holy night, the night that Christ was born. God bless you. I wish you a very Merry Christmas, you, your family, and friends, and may you have a safe and happy Christmas. Amen.